There and welcome to the Not Worldwide's Learn a Latte series. My name is Shannon Castleman and I'm a manager of recruiting here at the Not Worldwide. And today I'm joined by our very own VP of People, Tawanda Johnson. Tawanda, welcome. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Shannon. I'm excited to be here virtually.
Yes. Awesome. And I do have to show everyone your mugs. Let's do a quick coffee. Cheers.
Cheers.
You're a lot cooler than mine. Well-behaved women seldom make history. I love that quote. Very fitting. Awesome. So let's just start off first a little bit about your background.
I've been in HR now 18 years, and it's unbelievable to think that I have been in this profession for so long. And I guess the old saying, when you're having fun, it just doesn't seem like work at all. I fell into HR actually, I would say accidentally. I had always wanted to be an attorney. And so that was my initial dream of going to college. However, working full time and being in school full time, I had to make some difficult decisions around my education and just could not see the light at the end of the tunnel for me to actually afford to pursue a degree in law. And so while working full time, I worked at a call center and an opening came up for a recruiting coordinator. And I decided to put my name in the hat. And as they say, the rest is history. I got the job, started as a recruiting coordinator, eventually moved into a recruiter role, and from there moved up into the HR generalist spot. And then from there, my career has just progressed over time.
Awesome. I know. I feel like when I talk to a lot of other HR professionals, there's not a lot of people that know right away they want to be in HR or recruiting, even, for instance. Everyone kind of stumbles into it. Then once you're in it, it's such a great field. So I think your story relates to quite a few others, including my own.
Absolutely. And I also think that I have that little bit of employment law that still gives me that piece or aspect of the legal field, if you will. Not an attorney, but it gives me that aspect to be able to do some of the things that I've always wanted to do.
Right. Awesome. Absolutely. So what do you love most about being a leader here at the Not Worldwide?
Oh my goodness. I don't know that we have enough time for me to answer that question. I love everything about the Not Worldwide TKWW. I would say what stands out most for me is the culture. I felt it from, honestly, prior to me even joining the team, I felt the warm welcome. And certainly once I came on board, it was evident that this is a culture that truly cares. The employees are competitive, but in a very healthy way. And everyone wants to do the right thing and win the right way. And so that just keeps me excited day in and day out.
That's awesome. So, you know, speaking of the culture and our team, so we're both on the people team. Can you tell me a little bit about how your team is structured, some of the responsibilities it has, and the greater impact it has on the organization?
Definitely. I would say my scope is pretty wide. I am extremely fortunate and honored to have so many different functions that fall under my umbrella, if you will. And so I'm responsible for leading diversity, equity, and inclusion, which is very near and dear to my heart. I'm also responsible for overseeing employee experience. And then I'm also responsible for learning and development, as well as leading a team of rock star HR business partners.
Awesome. I know you've actually, crazy enough, only been at the Not Worldwide for, I think, a couple months now, which hopefully have already flown by, but what has made it, you know, a unique experience thus far?
I have historically worked for extremely large employers. So, you know, 10,000 plus companies that have more than 10,000 employees. And so this is definitely a smaller number of employees. So that's a key difference. I would say in terms of competitiveness and innovation, I see no difference, which is huge. So it means that we are small and agile, but extremely innovative, creative thinkers, think outside of the box. And I also like that the company is very strategic. It's not focused on the here and now, it's focused on where are we going to be years down the road. And so those are some of the key differences that I see.
Awesome. That's great.
Also say one of the things that I love is the ability to impact change without having to go through so many different layers. And so with bigger companies, there are multiple layers of leadership and executives that you've got to funnel through in order to make things happen. Whereas here, we don't have all those levels and layers. So it makes it a lot easier to drive results.
Yeah, exactly. You have, I feel like, a lot of autonomy in your role, no matter what level. And speaking of driving change and driving results, so you mentioned one of your key focus areas of responsibility is around diversity, equity, and inclusion. So I would love to hear a little bit more about the Knot Worldwide's impact areas around diversity, equity, inclusion, and some of the goals we have as a business.
We have four impact areas. One, our team members. We are hyper-focused on having diversity, equity, and inclusion in our teams and ensuring that all employees feel that their voice is heard and that they matter. Our second impact area is our community, where we support Black and other underrepresented groups in our local communities. Also, our engaged couples. We commit to leveraging our product and content to serve and highlight our diverse and underrepresented groups. And then last but certainly not least, our vendors. We commit to supporting the success of our Black and other underrepresented groups as business owners within our Wedding Pro community. So those are the four impact areas that we're hyper-focused on.
Great. That's awesome. And how do you feel like employees, whether they're, you know, in your own team or even outside of your team, how can they get involved with some of these initiatives or even just stay informed around some of these goals?
I would say dive in. We have a diversity, equity, and inclusion council. We also have affinity groups. Actually, we are now moving to employee resource groups that I would encourage employees to connect on Slack. Definitely feel free to send me an email as well.
Great. And speaking of another focus area on your greater team, how do you feel that the learning and development function also impacts the greater DE&I initiatives that we have?
Learning and development is foundational. You've got to have that learning piece, which for me is the educational component. There are so many misconceptions about diversity, equity, and inclusion. A lot of times people instantly think that diversity is solely about ethnicity. It's a, you know, Black or white thing. When in actuality, diversity, equity, and inclusion, it's so many more things. So it's zip code, whether you grew up in a single parent household or you have parents who are the same sex. So there's so many different components of diversity, equity, and inclusion. And that learning and development piece is critical in helping our employees become familiar with what diversity, equity, and inclusion is, as well as helping our leaders support and promote an inclusive environment.
I mean, that's fantastic. Everything you just said really highlights why learning and development is so critical to an organization overall and to, you know, the diversity, equity, and inclusion piece. So now time for some fun facts, lightning round questions. So what is the best business book, or it doesn't even have to be business, maybe it could just be impactful, book that you read recently?
Dare to Lead by Brené Brown. It just forces you to think about having tough but necessary conversations and a ton of self-reflection.
That's all the time we have here for today. So Tawanda, thank you so much for joining us and for all of the insight you gave into HR, into DE&I, into the Knot Worldwide, and to our viewers. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you soon. Thank you.
Thanks, Bye.